Hello and welcome to QBD Crime Club, where we are tripping across the globe virtually to chat to an author who is as renowned for his brilliant dark humour as he is for conjuring up brutal serial killers in epic thrillers to talk about no less the devil. It is wonderful to chat to Stuart Macbride. Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
It is, Stuart, so exciting for our Australian audiences to hear from you. I suppose one of the very few upsides of a couple of COVID years is that authors have really been able to spread their wings and tell their stories via this sort of method.
It's really weird though, because events, normally all the authors I speak to, we do our utmost to make the audience laugh when we're doing events. And every single event that's been done through Zoom has just been so sober and serious, because there's none of the feedback. You don't get anything off the audience. You don't know if there's anybody out there at all. So everything became a discussion of literature and how things work and narrative structure, the way of the world. It's been dreadful.
It is. You don't realise the energy you get from people, do you? Having them in the room, how much you feed off of that, even if they're silent. It's
like that, yeah. Silence.
It has been, I found really the last couple of years quite fascinating to get insights from creative folks like you. You know, a lot of writers have really relished the solitude and they haven't, you know, found it too isolating at all. Others have really found it difficult. When you're writing scary stories as you do, I imagine too much time alone mightn't be too good.
Well, I've worked from home for the last 16 years. So technically the lockdown has been very little different from what my normal life has been. The only difference is that I haven't been able to actually go anywhere. And I think a lot of people have discovered from lockdown and working from home that what makes it bearable is being able to actually just sod off somewhere nice and maybe have lunch or go up to the coast and buy fish, anything other than just being in the house the whole time. So yeah, that whole thing has just reinforced the whole how isolated we are, and we're lucky in that. I mean, we are in the middle of absolutely nowhere, so we are surrounded by, there are fields on most sides, trees on the other, and you know, we are, come the zombie apocalypse, we will be the last to be eaten.
You are. I mean, do you think that's one of the reasons internationally you've had such great success is that Scotland is such a, and the scenes that you set for us are such a part of all of your stories, that people, you really take people places and you build it so beautifully into your books?
Oh, basically, I'm a genius. I'm a wonderful genius. No, I honestly have no idea. I'm certainly very surprised that as many people like the books as they do, and I'm hugely grateful for that. I don't know if it's because I treat every single character as if they were a human being rather than as a pawn to move around because of the plot. So even the worst of my characters are human. You know, I don't do monsters. I do flawed people.
And is that okay? So
that was very serious, wasn't it?
Yeah, no, but that's good. But that kind of makes sense, because I read that you don't like true crime, that you do make up these character, you know, you don't like reading true crime because they're real people and bad things are happening to real people. So I suppose that's why you invest in these characters that you've created in books for the last sort of 17 or so years.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the really good things about crime fiction, is that it doesn't just give us that whole sort of vicarious view on bad things happening to people, but it also gives us reasons why they happen. And in real life, we rarely ever get those. Yeah. You know, Harold Shipman killed hundreds of people, and nobody has a clue why, because he wouldn't tell anybody. And that's, real life is much less satisfying than fiction.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? And that, so in terms of that sort of research though, you must have to have built the characters that you've built for so many years and to give us those kind of insights into the darkness. What sort of research have you done over time? And do you continue that as an ongoing thing, or do you know enough now about the dark side?
Well, the biggest piece of research I ever did on the dark side of human nature is marry a woman from Fife. And, you know, that just gives you a whole view into the hellish maelstrom that is the darker side of the psyche. Don't tell her I said that, by the way. Do not tell her I said that.
I'm hoping she's not listening.
I'm hoping she is, because it should make her laugh.
Is it true? I was reading some bibs and bobs about you, and it talked about that when you first got into writing, because you had a life obviously before books became your life, that you part of the reason you got involved was that you had friends who were writing and you kind of were doing what they did. Is that true?
Well, they were writing fantasy novels for hobbies and said it was a fun, you know, it was something fun to do with your time off. So I'll give it a go. You know, what's the worst that could happen? Always been a huge reader all my life. And instead of being a sensible person and starting with a short story, I jumped straight into a big full-length novel, a big crime, sort of comedy crime novel about two hitmen from Glasgow, from Glasgow trying to finish up their order book because they had a backlog of people that had to be killed. And they are being pursued by sinister government forces that they don't know about. And it's the Inland Revenue because they want their 40% of the money that these guys earn from killing people. And it gets sillier and sillier and sillier. And it is terrible. It is such an awful book. So, so, so bad.
Not redeemable? Not something you could rescue?
I could maybe turn it into something like a three-part series for BBC Scotland. I think it would work for that. But as an actual novel, oh, it is so bad. It is so bad. We're not allowed to swear. That's how bad it is.
Well, thankfully you weren't deterred. And I'm wondering, how did it work out for the friends? Do they sort of claim that they spurred you on to greatness? Did any of them go on to greatness as well?
I don't know. We haven't spoken for years.
Too famous now.
I'm fabulous, darling. Fabulous.
Yeah, I love it. I guess you've given us characters over the years, Logan McCrae, Ash Henderson. People feel really passionate about those characters, don't they? They've really come to know them. And when you decide you're going to step away from that and perhaps write a standalone or change what you're doing in a series, how do you go about that? Is there a big board? Is life mapped out? Or how do you go about that process of whether what comes next for you?
A lot of it is what interests me. I do know that if I spend too much time in the shoes of one character, I will become bored with them. And at some point I will kill them off because I just cannot stand to be in their company any longer. You know what it's like when somebody comes to visit your house and they stay for 3 days and that's fine, but day four, you just want to batter their head in with a saucepan? That's, you know, and I am spending pretty much every single day with Logan for a year at a time to write a book. So if I do two Logan books in a row, I've had him in my house for 2 years. Yes. And I just, someone else, anyone else.
And I suppose as well, because you know him so, you know, like you know Logan so well. So yeah, you can kind of get tired of him. I know exactly what you mean. I want to tiptoe carefully through the story. This is the new one that you've sent out into the world. I imagine, is it still the same sense of anticipation and nerves and excitement when you're launching one after all these years?
it's that weird, it's a bit like quantum physics. A book exists in a superposition of all states between a really great book and a terrible book. And the only difference is who reads it. So, you know, take, for example, The Da Vinci Code. You know, massive, massive international bestseller. Sold millions and millions and millions of copies. Some people absolutely love that book, think it's the best thing that's ever been written. Other people think it's a terrible pile of dross that, you know, can barely string a sentence together, and it's exactly the same book. So the actual book itself is secondary to the person reading it. So I always worry when a new book goes out there, because some people will love it and some people will hate it.
And you have to be thick-skinned, particularly these days when everyone can get in touch with you so easily and when there's so much, you know, information out there as well. I want to tiptoe carefully through this because I'm very mindful of spoilers because you have a lot going on here, but it's quite the trifecta, isn't it? You've got a serial killer, the Bloodsmith, you've got the media whipping up a frenzy as they do, and then the police hierarchy demanding results. And that you sort of give us two stories in one, don't you? Do you want to take us through the premise of No Less the Devil?
Well, Operation Maypole have been hunting the Bloodsmith for about 17 months now, and they're no nearer catching the man than they were on day one. As you say, the media are just going berserk about the story. The Hygiens are just, give us a result now or else. People are starting to distance themselves from the investigation as well, just to make sure that when this whole thing falls apart, they don't get anything stuck to them. So now is really not the time for Detective Sergeant Lucy McVeigh to get distracted. She needs to be focusing on this case. But Benedict Strachan, when he was 11 years old, hunted down and really, I mean, stabbed about 39 times a homeless man. Nobody knows why. He's never, ever given a motive. He's confessed to the crime, but never given a reason for it. And he's now out of prison after 16 years. And of course, he went in when he was 11. So he has never known the outside world. He has grown up in prison and has come out with a drug problem, because often it's easier to get drugs in prison than it is outside of prison. And he is wired, and he is weird, and he is paranoid. And when he sort of confronts Lucy and tells her that there is some sort of shadowy they out to get him, obviously it just sounds like nonsense. But, you know, what if he's actually right? What if the way that our world is structured, with all the horrible things that happen in our governments, you know, the way it always seems to be set up so that they can enrich themselves and their friends at the expense of all us little people, what if that's not an accident? What if that's actually how the world works? And what if going against these people will cost Lucy her life? He said in his voiceover voice at the end.
Very good voiceover voice, Stuart. That's fantastic. Oh my goodness.
I'm used to do voiceovers.
Two very compelling storylines, you know what I mean? Because the thought, because you, again, you put yourself in the shoes and you're thinking, you can't imagine an 11-year-old doing what happens when this story kicks off, but it is running alongside a serial killer. So it's, you actually, I felt myself the first sort of couple of chapters, my heart was racing and I was feeling a bit, because it's a lot to take in. And that's, I guess, as part of that title, No Less the Devil, is it makes you start thinking about all of that bad stuff that's out there.
Yeah, and I can't even take credit for that. That was somebody at Transworld. I have disinvested myself from titles years and years ago, because sales and marketing would always change them at HarperCollins. So I have written books called Logan McRae Number 9, because I know it's going to get changed. There's no point in getting bound up in what the book is called. But I think they came up with a lovely title. I'm hoping they'll do the same for the next one.
Yeah, absolutely. You do, as you are renowned for, as I said off the top, you are renowned for kind of injecting a lot of dark humour into your books, and it almost gives you a bit of a relief as a reader. But is that part of how you cope with the types of stories that you write as well, or is it just who you are?
Well, when I started writing crime fiction, there was very little humour in books. Ian Rankin, for example, would put one awful pun in each title, and that would be it. That would be the extent of it. Everybody was writing all these grim-faced detective stories where the detective goes to work and they all stand around and go, "This is horrible. Yes, it is so sad. What shall we do? Let us find the killer. Yes, that is all we will do. We are robots to catch the killer. This is what we will be doing for the next 300 pages." And that's just not how police officers are. Because, shock horror, police officers are people just like we are. So when I started writing, what I did was I basically treated the police like the people I had worked with, because I've worked in teams pretty much my entire adult life. So I just made my police officers act like people do in teams. And that is, they take the mickey out of each other. Yeah. They find humor whatever they can. Some are brilliant, some are thick, some lie in between. Sometimes the brilliant people have thick moments, sometimes the thick people have brilliant moments. Yeah. And that's just what I brought to the stories. So I think Now We Are Dead is the only book that I've written that has comedic scenes in it. Every other book, the comedy always comes from how the characters interact with each other. So, and having now spent a lot of time with police officers, I know that that is exactly how they are in real life. They are just like people. They present this very staid front to the public when they're on. But as soon as they are backstage with each other, all bets are off.
How's that feedback? If you've obviously spent a lot of time with police, and do they kind of give you tips on what you might or might not? And how do they receive it after all this time?
Oh, my favourite ever piece of feedback was after my second book, I think. came out. So this is, you know, this would have been 2006, long, long time ago. And a friend of mine who was, I think he was a detective inspector at the time, was speaking to a sergeant. And the sergeant had gone, "Have you read that Stuart Macbride's latest book?" Said, "Oh, yes. Yeah. What did you think of it?" And he said, "It's full of factual inaccuracies." "Cool. Well, I'd read that and I thought it was all right. But what did he get wrong?" He says there's a coffee machine on the third floor. There's no coffee machine on the third floor. And that had broken the spell for him, because I had put this fictitious coffee machine in force headquarters where there wasn't one.
And, if, you know, how great, because if that's the worst thing he did, isn't that fantastic, really? That was it.
Well, there will always be something that will spoil it for someone.
So where did Detective Sergeant Lucy McVeigh come from? How did you build this character?
Well, she actually comes from a long time ago. I was, being international and fabulous, I was invited to a crime festival in Johannesburg in South Africa. So knowing it was an overnight flight, and I never, ever, ever sleep, I decided I would just work, because it's that, or I sit there and watch some horrible movie for the entire time. And Radio 4 over here had asked me, would I do a short story that they could read out, that they would get an actor to do. So I thought, okay, because I've got this big 8-12 hour flight, I will just do that. So I wrote a short story for them, and it was decided when I sent it in that it was far too dark, and there was no way on earth they could ever put that on the air. Would I do something else instead? So I did. So I wrote a short story, and it featured Lucy as a child. And that was the first time I had ever encountered her. And, you know, so that got broadcast, and that was fine. But for years, it just sat in the back of my head, and I just wondered, what would Lucy be like when she grew up? And what would it be like if she joined the police? And then the pandemic happened, and of course over here we had all the delightful things that happened with, you know, we're not allowed to use the word criminality, but let's say it was suspicious that certain people who were very friendly with the governing party were given contracts worth hundreds of millions of pounds to produce PPE that quite often didn't work, didn't meet standards. They got all this public money, no qualifications in supplying PPE, no background to it, no experience to it, but massively enriched by the people who have their hands in our pockets, because it's our money that was given to these people. And that really annoyed me. And that started to kick off in my head the whole, you know, nobody's accountable anymore. Everybody just gets, if you're a powerful person, if you are in that position, that strata, you get away with everything. And it doesn't matter what happens, nothing sticks. You can break the law, you can break your own rules, you do whatever you like, nothing ever happens. There's no accountability. And I started thinking, well, what if that's not a bug in the system? What if that's the way the system is set up? Yeah. And those two things just went squish. And that's how No Less the Devil started.
Wow, I love that that's a story that's come from so long ago for you, that you've had this character or this person there and you bring her through, because what we do know, and again, no spoilers, she's had a very hard past and PTSD is part of who she is and the story. And the way you bring that out, it's confronting but also sensitive. You know, it's because you can tell she's a character you care about.
Oh, I care about all of them, even the Bloodsmith I care about.
Did you have a plan for how you would reveal her and her story, or does that unfold as you're writing it?
Well, this one, because it's the first book, The Trans World, I was with HarperCollins for 16 years. I thought, well, I'd better make sure that they're happy and, you know, just give them confidence of what I'm going to deliver here. So I planned, unusually for me, I planned the whole book out from start right through to the finish. And I normally, you know, I would never do that. I would maybe plan the first third and then find out where it goes from there. So, but I wanted them to be comfortable. So yeah, for this one, I knew exactly what was going to happen every single step of the way.
You also built that partnership. You can tell when you talk about your characters and how you like all of them, the way you built the partnership, that sort of the banter of the dialogue between her and Dunk.
No. I have to stop you there. It's the Dunk.
The Dunk, sorry. Of course.
If you're talking to him, he's Dunk. If you're talking about him, he's the Dunk.
That's actually quite Aussie, to be honest. That's something that we would do.
But I have no idea where that came from or why. It just seemed to be, yep, no, I'm just going to do that for the entire thing.
I like it. But that's obviously where you give us part of that, you know, your humour as well. But that you feel like that's the way we get to know them both and really build that sort of strength of their relationship is through that sort of camaraderie, isn't it, with that language?
Yeah, and it's also it's a lot of fun to write the Dunk because he gets to rant about stuff, which is nice. And sometimes I will give opinions that I agree with to characters that we're supposed to hate, and opinions that I disagree with characters that we're supposed to love. So it's not that, you know, we've all read those soapbox books where you know exactly what the author thinks about something, because the hero protagonist will rant on about it for about three pages. I'd like to mix it up. So sometimes the baddies will say things that I agree with, and sometimes the goodies will say things that I don't. But the Dunk was a lot of fun.
Dunk. I love it. And I think that comes across. And it's so funny when we're talking about a book that has so many, you know, it's dark in so many ways, but to talk about the fun that a character has given you is pretty interesting as well. A lot of psychology in this book. You say to us, it's on the back and it's on all of the headlines. We are each our own devil and we make this world our hell. Is that a bigger picture thing, or is that more about what our minds can do and the power of the mind and how terrifying that can all be?
Well, it's an Oscar Wilde quote, yeah. Which sort of seems might seem a little strange to be putting on the back of a crime novel. Yeah. They always say hell is other people. But really, it's how you personally relate to those other people. Even though I agree, huge crowds of it, but it's how you personally react to that situation that makes your world better or worse. We are all in control of that, and there's that sort of undercurrent throughout the book where our experiences are very much personal. And how things happen is coloured and shaded by who we are. I'm trying very hard not to give anything away at all.
Me too. I'm really stepping around those conversations as well. You know, you mentioned before that power and the power of those that have it and how they continue to wield it. There's quite a bit of, I suppose, in some ways, social commentary around parenting and impacts on society and on our kids, about homelessness, about mental health. Were you aware you were doing all of those things in this book, or is it just part of the telling of the story?
I've said this so many times, but I really believe it to be true. Crime fiction is probably the best genre of fiction at holding a mirror up to society. And often it shows us what we're scared of as a collective, but it also shows us the world that we live in. I could have just edited all that stuff out and just had it about nothing but the hunt for the killer. But that, I think that would be a very sort of anorexic tale, rather than, as you can see, my own full pandemic pie. anti-sveltness. So yeah, it would be like missing the ingredients in a dish. It just wouldn't taste right at the end. You could get something edible, but
because intelligent readers are looking for more than that, aren't they? I mean, I must say, even in Australia this year in 2022, we've seen quite a number of female debut novelists, debut authors, and the theme is very much about domestic violence and coercive control and what's going on in our society. And it's really important because they're books that people who might not necessarily pay attention to the news will pick up, and it gives that snapshot of society. So actually what you're saying is right. It can be a really powerful tool, a fiction book.
And is this very, very recently has happened?
Yeah.
So that does make me... Again, with the holding up the mirror thing, it does suggest that the initial year, at least, of lockdown has seen a big spike in domestic violence, because that's now coming out in the fiction.
Yeah.
Because normally there would be a year's lead time between writing and publication.
And it is, I mean, and you're right, it is, yeah, it does hold up a mirror, it is reflective of society, but you also give us, the other thing you do as well is you haven't missed out on giving us all a bit of heart palpitations and quite a thrill as well, because you've got some great characters and great stories. Did you, I'm not going to give anything away, but you did a certain way through the book really flip things on its head, and you gave the readers a real, oh, did you absolutely intentionally do that to do things differently this time around?
Yeah. And what I like to write for rereaders. So I really hope people will, once they get to the end of the book, maybe give it a month or two and go back to the start and be able to go through and see that it wasn't just some sort of weird switch. That was like, it's there from the very first of the book. You can, once you know what's happening, you can go back and go, ah, okay, yes, now I see why this happens. Aha, that's completely different. Now I know what's going on. So is this. Oh, I didn't realize that was the reason for this, but you know, it's now really, really clear. So I've always enjoyed writing that way. I don't like to explain things to the reader, because I think people who read, you know, they are clever people, otherwise they wouldn't be reading. So I love the thought that somebody will go back through the book and go, oh,
hang on a minute,
oh,
yes.
Yeah, ooh, this is actually a really sinister thing, but it looked perfectly innocent the first time through.
When you've had a character that's been with you a long time, since they were a child and here they are you thinking as you're writing, could this be a series? I only want this to be, I mean, is your mind leaping forward, or are you only ever in the book?
I'm only ever in the book until I get to the end of it. I don't know if Lucy will ever be back. It sort of depends if people like her or not. And also, my slight worry is that if I write another book about Lucy, it will spoil the first book if you haven't read it.
Yeah.
So you won't get that same experience if you read a second book in this, if it became a series.
Yeah.
So I don't know what's going to happen there.
But how nice is it to have options? How nice is it to have those choices and know that there's something else percolating in the background? So once you've given us a
few... Well, I have a wall board here that is just covered with scribbles and with post-it notes of things to do in the future. So it's not as if I'm short of stuff to write about. I will never live long enough to write all the books I would like to write. I would have to be 200, 300.
Oh, that is so exciting to think that all of that is in your mind or on your pin board, and all of those ideas are there.
Most of it will never, ever get out.
Well, I'm sure your fans are thrilled that there's a whole lot still awaiting them. And I know your fans right around the world, but certainly here in Australia, are really excited to have No Less the Devil finally out there. Thank you so much for joining us on Crime Club, and congratulations. And hopefully we will see you in real life someday soon.
Oh, I would love that. I would absolutely love that. Australia and New Zealand, two of my favourite places to go to. So I've got my fingers crossed that we'll actually be able to get back to that sometime soon.
Be amazing. Thank you, Stuart.
Cheers.